This episode of Artist Decoded is brought to you by No Wave Academy. No Wave Academy offers college-level art courses at a fraction of the price. Learn from some of today's best contemporary and fine artists. Artist Decoded is offering 10% off of all of their online courses. Go to No Wave Academy, that's NOHWaveAcademy.com. Type in AD10, all caps, at checkout for 10% off. They recently released a figure composition basics course taught by master oil painter Aaron Westerberg. They also recently released a course entitled Layering the Portrait in Oils, taught by recent Artist Decoded guest Mia Bergeron. So go to nohwaveacademy.com, that's NOHWaveAcademy.com, type in AD10, all caps, at checkout for 10% off. Now, on to the episode. Hey, everybody. How's it going? This is your host, Yoshino, and you're listening to episode 138 of Artist Decoded. In this episode, my friend, Yore, aka Jarrell Perry, gets the opportunity to talk to painter Maja Ruznic. And I'm on the phone right now with Jarrell. How's it going, man?
I'm doing good. Thanks for having me. Every time I get to interview someone for Artist Decoded, it's a privilege. And it was cool to do this interview with Maja because we had known each other in the past and even done a podcast in the past, a live one for Mindwave about two years ago. Great to catch up with her and learn about her new life in Roswell, New Mexico with her partner, her fiance, Josh Hagler, who's also been on the podcast a few times. We talked a little bit about her art and how she channels, she feels like she's channeling, the pain of people and trauma from other places and other periods of time. It was really interesting conversation.
Yeah, I definitely like how you and Maja were talking about recognizing and healing from pain and trauma. And yeah, it's interesting because I think she was talking about how in the contemporary art world, how it's kind of unpopular, especially when it's in terms of like art academia, to talk about spirituality within your work and being connected, you know, to your spiritual self. And I always find it interesting to talk about education of art, especially like on the collegiate level, because a lot of the philosophies seem to be so much different than intuitively creating artwork. And yeah, I like that you guys were talking about that and practicing isness, which I thought was funny. Just the idea of isness, you know, as being a word, I think is funny, but it's just really about practicing being present. And I think that is just something that is really dear to you as well as a person and creative. Am I right?
Yeah, absolutely. You know, I've been going through a journey towards, you know, more mindfulness and more wellness as it relates to my identity as an artist and as a human being for these last couple of years. So whenever I get to talk to someone who gets it in the same way that I'm trying to get it, you know, as a person who creates for themselves and for the public, it's really gratifying.
Yeah, definitely. Where can we find you?
Oh yeah.
On social media. I think at the end of the episode, we talked to Maja, or you talked to Maja, about, you know, where you can find her, but where can we find you?
Oh yeah. So I have new music that you can find on my Instagram at This Is Yore, Yore. You can also follow my mindfulness journey at Still Mind Co.
Yeah. Thanks so much for taking the time to do this. I really appreciate it.
No, thank you.
Before we begin this episode, please go to our iTunes page and leave us a review. It helps for viewers just like yourself to hear about this podcast. It also helps us secure sponsorship. So if you could do that, that would be greatly appreciated. So here it is, you're in conversation with Maja Ruznic for Artist Decoded. Hope you enjoy.
Okay.
Just a little bit. There we go. Maja, thank you for joining the show.
Thank you so much for having me. So official.
I know. We've had you on a few times before, but it's been almost 2 years since the last time. I think we were doing a live panel thing.
Yeah, there were like five of us or something like
that. Yeah, talking about who knows.
Yeah. What. Yeah, I forget what it was, but we were all...
I remember one question. Somebody, I think it was Josh, who was like, where does intuition come from or something?
Uh-huh. I asked that question or I was responding to it?
You asked it, I think. And I was like, wow, that's an insane question.
How dare you ask?
Yeah. We rolled off, but.
I don't know if I still know where, it, I mean, I don't think.
Yeah. And then I said something about the isness of things.
Ah, yes.
And
yes,
the presence.
Yes.
And just finding those moments.
I was talking to a friend about isness last night.
Really?
And how isness is really like a true surrender to the situation where you don't feel like you have to do something about it.
Right. And there's nothing to fix.
There's nothing to fix. Yeah, something I'm trying to practice every day with the work, but also being a human and being alive. But also like having agency and responding to things where you feel, you know, not fully disengaging.
Right.
You know, still being engaged in the world, but not feeling like the ego wants to fix, you know.
Right.
Rather be in like a channel.
Yeah.
You know,
I feel like... the way that I've heard it characterizes responding versus reacting. So much of life, modern life, I guess, is reactionary. It's like, especially for example, with your phone.
Sure.
It's like you get a notification. It's like, okay, I got to react. I think a response is something that's a little bit more like coming from the inside.
I'm more versus, thoughtful. Maybe a more, intentional place.
Yeah.
Where you've kind of been with it for a minute.
Yeah.
For a minute.
Yeah.
You know, a long minute, hopefully.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
No, that's interesting. And I also we live in a time when we're almost expected to react quickly.
Yeah.
You know, like, what are you going to do about it?
Yeah. And if
there's
you don't.
There's bad stuff happening.
Yeah.
And if you don't, you're almost seen as a, what's the word, like escapist or kind of... what I was saying earlier, like not engaged with what's happening.
Mm-hmm.
And yeah, since we've moved to Roswell and we've been living out in the desert, I realized that there's a whole different sense of time in places that are not urban and kind of moving fast.
Mm-hmm.
That's always there. We just don't have access to it in a place that moves so fast.
Right.
But that's isness.
Right.
And isness is here too.
Yeah.
It's just so much noise. We don't feel it.
Yeah, it's just underneath all of the the noise.
Yeah, exactly.
So yeah, tell me a little bit more about Roswell and how you ended up there.
Yeah.
You've been there for over a year now? Or?
Year and a half.
Wow.
In November, it'll be 2 years. Yeah, so we were living in LA for about 4 years after leaving the Bay Area, Josh and I, because we couldn't afford to stay there anymore. And LA was really great for us for the time being, but we also felt like we were starting to feel like we were hustling so hard.
Mm-hmm. And Josh is your fiance.
He's my fiance.
Yes.
Yeah. Yeah. Sorry.
Also an artist.
Also an artist. And we met through the art world, which is kind of like this kind of cliche thing, you know, where'd you meet? At the gallery, you know?
Yeah.
And that's actually,
so that's
really
literally what happened.
Yeah. We met at, a gallery in San Francisco called Alter Space. I had, I was taking down a show and he was doing a residency there. So, but we knew of each other's work before too. So anyways, we were living here. We love, and we still are in touch with the art community that we've, fostered while living here. I mean, that's one thing that I would say we really miss about LA is the art community. It's like people here are so supportive of one another. But we were working way too hard to kind of make ends meet. So Josh received the Artist in Residence grant, which is a year-long program, and they paid him to make work. There was a stipend, and they gave both of us studios, which
That's
we didn't
awesome.
Know. They didn't. I didn't know that they would have space for a spouse who makes art. And when we got there, I was planning on finding a studio, but they were like, "Oh yeah, here's one for you," like same size as Josh's and everything. And I had access to the wood shop, so I learned how to make my own stretcher bars.
Stretcher bar, like
to stretch the canvas. Okay. Yeah. So I felt really empowered. Like I learned how to make everything about my painting from the stretcher bar to the final touches, you know? So it felt really good to do that. And for the first time ever, I had all the time in the world to paint.
Yeah.
And everything started changing from my palette to the way I thought about what painting is, what I want them to do. And my palette went from this like really saturated, almost feverish palette to a very, very pale, very lightly stained canvas because the colors I was using in LA didn't feel right in the desert. I would look out my window and everything was like this pale, pale color. And there's all this like wildlife, like we would see deer and jackrabbits and something about like neon pink didn't really feel right. So everything changed. And after Josh finished the residency, we moved into the alumni housing where we are now, which is subsidized housing where we have the same deal where we pay very little for a 3-bedroom house and 2 large studios. Wow. And an amazing community. So we're in New Mexico, and we will stay in New Mexico, probably not Roswell for too much longer. We've been saving to hopefully buy something like near Santa Fe.
Yeah.
But New Mexico, we both sort of looked at each other and we're like, this is home.
That's amazing.
And I don't know. I don't know if I would have ever, as a person who left Bosnia, you know, during the war and all that, no place really felt like home. I always felt transient. But something about the land and the landscape of New Mexico really feels, I think of it as like the grandmother that's hugging us. Mm. That's like, my children, you are here, you're safe, make the work.
Yeah, that's amazing. Do you feel like there's something more grounded or, I don't know, ancient or old about living on land over there that's not necessarily disrupted by, you know, urban planning?
Well, you know, at the risk of sounding like I'm romanticizing sort of places like that, and I know that it sounds that way, but I do feel that land contains information and energy, and something feels sacred there. You know, I don't know what it is, but it's like on an intuitive level, on a bodily level, on a cellular level, my body recognizes something that feels like I'm in touch with an old way of being, and that really suits my spirit. I don't think it's for everyone.
Right.
We have people coming through and they're like, why do you guys live here? Mm. This is like the armpit. Because Roswell's not really a happening place, but we're not really there for what it has to offer, like entertainment. We're there for this like sense of vastness. You know, we look out our window and it's like just desert and mountains and wildlife. And it, I do think it's good for the mind to not see information everywhere that's man-made.
Right.
You know, something that's just to see nature is, and I was worried that we were escaping reality. You know, the world is definitely not peaceful. I don't think it ever was. And I think it feels like it's more crazy now, especially because we have more access to information, right? Like we're all on our phones. We get updates, like live updates all the time. So the world does seem like it's burning, but I feel that, I won't speak for Josh, but for me, I feel like every artist has a purpose and a strength. And I made peace with the fact that my message or my job as an artist is not to react on a sort of like an activist on a political level. Mm-hmm. But I like to think of myself almost like as like accessing like pressure and like chakra points and making work from that place that hopefully has a healing quality on a nonverbal level.
Yeah.
Where it's like, I might not be directly speaking about the white supremacy that's so prevalent, but I am talking about that. And it's like the underbelly, but what's underneath it, you know? And I feel like living out there allows me to speak from that place and not this reactive place. We were just talking about reaction versus response.
Yeah, that's amazing. I love that perspective about the chakra points or the, you know, that pressure points of something that's a little bit more visceral. And I was reading or listening to another interview that you had done talking about how you used to do a lot of writing before and how moving into a visual medium is something a little bit more, you know, I guess broad or underneath the skin, maybe like a little bit less direct.
Yeah, you know, I did. I mean, as you know, a lot of artists say, oh, from the time that I was four, I knew I wanted to be an artist, or I knew I wanted to be a singer, or I didn't really have that strong sense of I'm going to be a painter, or I'm going to be an artist, you know. But I was always, I remember just observing. I was really I was very curious about shapes, like the shadows and the way that they danced on the floor, and how seeing the shadow kind of quivering on the pavement, it would trigger a memory. Mm. And all of a sudden I'd be thinking about my grandpa. And I was always very interested in like the way the brain kind of like almost like beads, it strings on little bits of information, and a whole world of emotion is happening just from visual things. So I think when I kind of, I was writing a lot of poetry as a teenager. I was kind of that emo kid, you know. Yeah. I was really into running, long distance running, which is kind of like isolating. You're out there in the, and then writing was also this is, but I think it's also because I, like, English was my third language. So after we left Bosnia, we moved to Austria, where I had to learn to speak German. Mm-hmm. Then as, when I was 12, we moved to the US, and then I had to learn how to speak English. So all these verbal, like obstacles, and I felt like I was bursting inside and words were never adequate. So I would say that's when I started really thinking in this nonverbal, abstract way. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I was, this is the Austin Meyer podcast that I think you're talking about. Yeah. But I was talking about almost having, I'm not a synesthete. I don't have synesthetic abilities, but sometimes a color alone will sort of evoke a feeling or a memory, and that will be my starting point to make a whole body of work. Mm-hmm. And it became more fun, almost like a puzzle. Like with words, you know, everyone's telling you, like, use your words wisely, you know, right. Say what you mean, or, you know, so there's almost this like pressure to know exactly the right word for, you know, and Josh will sometimes in this like, in a way, but like make fun of how I construct a sentence. You know, it's like not always totally grammatically appropriate or right. like right. But to me, it makes more sense. And I feel like the way I paint, I'm allowed to do that. And nobody will say that's not quite right. Right. You know, it's a painting. And so I feel like I can be more inventive.
Yeah, maybe it's like the palette is your own language or your own yeah. lexicon. You're like, this is my language. And
absolutely,
you're free to use it.
Sure.
Yeah.
And it's not for, you know, not everyone will have a good response to it. Somebody will be like, oh, I don't know what this is, what I'm looking at. What is this? Is this a foot? Yeah. And I'm like, tell me what you think.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And people don't always like that.
Yeah.
But I'm very interested in the space of like not being able to name something.
Yeah.
Because I feel like that's where all the juicy stuff is.
Mm-hmm.
You know, like the space before we use words to describe. Like, what's that?
Yeah, I love that. It seems like working at the subconscious level, something that's maybe a little bit more emotional.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I'm very interested in emotions. I mean, when people say I'm not really emotional, I don't really believe them.
Yeah.
I think we're all emotional. It's just how much you want to indulge that in you.
Right.
You
so, okay. So what about you as a person? Do you feel like...
Ask Josh. No, but I'll answer.
Like,
I'll
emotional... Like, I guess in the you know, typical sense of the word, like, do you feel like you're very outwardly expressive with your emotions? Are you, I've been researching a lot about psychology and this avoidant and anxious theory, mm-hmm. which basically is, have you heard of this in relationships?
Yeah.
Yeah, so like some people are avoidant of maybe like intimacy or their feelings.
Or even conflict, maybe avoiding conflict.
Yeah. And then others are maybe a little bit more codependent and mm-hmm. a little bit anxious and fearing abandonment. So
yep.
maybe their emotions manifest in a different way. That's a little bit more,
yeah.
you know.
Yeah. Well, I would say, and I think all my friends and family and Josh would agree that I'm very expressive. Sometimes that's a good thing, and sometimes it's like, okay, that's too much. You know, sometimes, you know, I need to kind of hold myself back. I remember I had a boyfriend in college who broke up with me because I was, quote, too much.
Oh.
So this became, it was actually like a wound, but also by naming it, by calling it that, he gave me something to think about for a while. Like, what does that mean? Too much compared to what?
Right.
Or, so yeah, I mean, I cry every day, anywhere between like once a day to like five times a day. And it's not always because I'm sad.
Yeah.
It's really easy to move me, to affect me. So, you know, it could be just seeing like a kitten on the street that's like super cute and like I'll get super teary eyed. It's like these big feelings, I call them big feelings that like are so big to fit in my body. They're just like the tears come out. Or when, you know, I talk to my sister and she says something that I feel like she's reached a little like personal milestone and I'm like so happy for her own, blossoming that I'm like on the phone and she's like, are you crying? I'm like, yeah, I'm just so happy for you, you know? So, sometimes it's overwhelming, you know, to feel that porous. I feel like the world like comes through me all and like, and sometimes I have no control over it. You know, people talk about, you have to work on building a bubble around yourself to protect yourself from like, you know, emotional vampires, you know, people who are kind of empiric in nature and all that. And I don't know. I mean, on some level I want to, but a part of me, I like being that open and walking around in this kind of like vulnerable, fragile way almost, is what I need to, well, I don't need it to make the work, but I think I need to stay open all the time to make work that I feel I need to produce to put into the world.
Yeah. That's striking. I feel like it, from what I experience of you saying that, it sounds like you've managed to find some empowerment in that.
Mm.
Like, do you feel like you always felt confident in that porousness or,
you know, I think when I was younger and in college, I feel like especially in college, you get like the label by your friends, like you're the wild one or like you're the mom of the group or you're the, so I was always the sort of like the wild kind of, exotic thing. That's like, ooh, what's Maja wearing tonight? You know, look at her dance or wow. You know, there was always this sort of like too much that was manifested in either clothes or what I made or what I said. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
That was almost like, it was too much like a thing. It wasn't embodied.
Right. It was like a character maybe or just a personality.
It was a person. And then I almost felt like I needed to continue serving that.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's like, well, I can't go out tonight and just wear a black t-shirt. Like people expect me to have this like crazy thing on. So, and I realized that part of like my truth was also performative.
Mm-hmm.
So, I think it was like, and I'm 35. So it was like around the time I turned 30, I realized, well, where is the authentic Maja where I'm no longer performing for people? And that's the Maja that actually was like much more like calm and actually not that extroverted and is like, I'm going to check out now, guys. See you later.
Yeah.
So yeah, it's something I think I arrived at. It was not something I always had.
Yeah.
Cause I wanted to fit in and I wanted to be cool. And then the older you get, the more you're like, I'm okay with not being cool. Actually.
Yeah, I love that. I love that feeling. I love that about getting older. You know, I think that's the best thing about getting older. It's just you stop caring.
You realize it's energy wasted.
Yeah.
And you need that energy.
And I feel like you're just more intentional about your energy. So you're like, hold up. Like, I'm not going to waste my time on this kind of, these kind of worries. And I also felt the same thing about the performative aspect of life, especially when you're an artist, you know, like I'm an artist, I do music. It is my job to perform. But then I also realized that for so much of my youth and my early 20s, I was performing for either my parents or my professors or my friends, or you like find a personality that works and that's very safe.
Sure.
Or something that really works for you. And it's like, all right, this is who I am, but then maybe it's not who you really are meant to be forever, you know?
Or maybe it's just one aspect of you.
Yeah.
Like
exactly.
The performer is there, but there's also the sort of like, the person who wants to cuddle up in a corner and not talk to for anyone, you know?
Yeah, and just being okay with that and saying, like, that's actually a good thing, too.
Sure.
You know, it's not something that you have to hide or it's not something that can't be accepted or mm-hmm. be loved.
Yeah, there's something about, you know, being like the stylized idea of who you are that somehow feels more safe, you mm-hmm. know, like you were saying earlier. And just like allowing room for multiplicities and contradictions within yourself. Like in one moment, you're sort of like this saint-like figure who's, and then in another moment, you're like, wow, that was a really dark thought you just had there, Maja. That's fucked up. Why did you think that, you know?
Yeah.
And not like living with that and being okay and saying like, I'm both.
Right.
That's also something that comes with aging, but also I think happened much easier when we moved away.
Oh, really?
When you can kind of like almost like lay out all your cards and you're like, wow, I'm all those things.
Mm-hmm.
This thing doesn't go with this thing, but it's all inside of me. And I don't know, like constantly getting in touch with who you are and see how it's changing. And
maybe not having to validate that to anyone else.
Yeah.
I was going to ask if, you know, social media and even, I guess, branding yourself as who you are as an artist or just the commercial aspects of the art world, do you feel like there was some pressure there to also fit into a character or a personality based on what your work is speaking? Or like, I don't know, there, I feel like different people have an idea of what a painter is, or it's like, I've been to some certain art shows and I'm like, oh, this is like the HBO version of a, of an art opening. Like everyone has, their outfit and their and their air and their accent, their art accent.
Sure. No, the whole thing is kind of a facade in a way, and especially with social media and Instagram. I mean, for a long time, I would say I was really caught up in that, you know, wanting to have a bunch of followers and the likes, and you post something and seeing, oh, that only got that many likes compared to this thing. You start realizing it's almost like back to the performer. You're performing for this audience of people that you've never even met, right? Who are going to applaud you for, you know, what Josh and I called like your swashbuckling painting.
Oh,
that's
yeah.
like big, nice colors, well photographed. And it's like, rah, here it is. I'm a painting. You'll get a lot of likes for that.
Yeah.
And we always like to make fun of like certain things that happen. Like when we shared that we were engaged, we both lost between the two of us like 100 followers.
Really?
Like I lost 60 in 2 days and he lost 40.
No
like,
way.
You know, and you can have an app to show you who unfollowed you, you know? And so you see who unfollowed you and you're like, wow, okay. So you don't care about this aspect of me, the fact that I'm in love. Yeah. You like my paintings.
You're actually like actively, no thanks.
No thanks. I don't want to see this.
Right.
And that's interesting, you know? So I'm like, I now post things that I know I'll lose follow. Like if I post a sculpture, for example, I'll get like 10 times less likes than if I post a big painting that's higher in contrast. So it's like, and you become like your own social scientist. You're like a low contrast, small painting next to a sculpture will get no likes, but it's actually in my show coming up. So I'm going to post it, you know? And then you realize that like, who is this for? Like who? Why are you curating your, and then you realize it's because you want to appear as being this grand person who has a lot of followers and all that. And I'm starting to care less and less about that, you know? And, but yeah, I think it's a sign of both maturity, but also realizing like, what is it that I want by posting this?
Yeah.
And, I realized that the things that really, like on a very concrete level, having a lot of followers doesn't mean you have enough money to pay rent, for example.
Right.
You know? And I realized, well, what do I want? I want to be able to afford the life that I have, and maybe I should spend more time making more work than like curating my social media profile.
Mm-hmm. But because in some cases, don't you feel that we're made to believe that the numbers do matter, at least in part to, you know, how much money you can make from a piece, or if you get some sort of notoriety. I guess there's a couple different ways to go about it. But
you know what I noticed? And actually, this is so interesting. I feel like within every appearance, there's like other things to consider.
Yeah.
So if you think about the really famous artists like that are in museums, if they are on Instagram, and I say if because they're not always, if they are, they have like 200 followers, but they're in like the Whitney Biennial, and they're like all over the world. The hustlers, they're really the people, I would put myself in that category, who don't have that. So you're trying like hustle your way up. So they're the ones who are trying to rack up the followers and all that. But it's really, and this is maybe a little like cutthroat to talk about it this way, but it's like you're trying to build up an audience only if you're not where you want to be. If you are where you want, like I know I have friends who are really, really doing well. They're like at the cream, like creme de la creme of the art world. They don't even need to have an Instagram account because their gallery posts a piece of theirs and their gallery has like 300,000 followers.
Right.
So they're working, like they have a team of people working for them. So now it's almost like you don't want to have too many followers because it shows that like you don't have any of those things. You're working hard for yourself. You're like this like blue collar worker of the art world.
That's wild. I never thought of it that way.
I didn't either until recently. And I'm like, wow. So you kind of have to, I don't know. I don't know what it means, but it's like all of this is happening at the same time.
Yeah.
And then it's like, well, which part of the art world do you want to be in? Do you want to be like
exactly.
popular, like super, like pop culture, where everyone loves you, but you make kind of shitty work?
Yeah.
Or do you want to have like a smaller group of followers, but you think of them as like high quality?
Yeah.
And that becomes elitist. And you're like, ooh, I don't want to be an elitist. But then you're like, oh, I don't want to become this like pop star artist.
Yeah, it's you know? Weird, right? Like, I think that also comes with just growth and age. And I think about my journey as an artist and through music and wanting to be super indie or super acclaimed. And then, no, actually, I want to make money from this. Or, okay, is there a middle ground to this?
Sure.
I don't know. Where do you, I know you just said you feel like a hustler in many ways, but.
But I'm doing that less. You know, I feel like when we were living in LA, I felt I was literally hustling and trying to, I mean, I had multiple jobs. I was very sick. Before we left, my hair was literally falling out from stress. My doctor was like, your immune system is breaking down and it thinks that you are going through a war or something.
Wow.
And I felt like my body was at war with me. Like, so I was having eczema and my hair was falling out. But that's because I was living in my car, driving to Anaheim to teach, coming back, teaching at La Sierra, coming back, doing all kinds of weird things just to sort of pay rent and never be in the studio. So the hustling and trying to create this image of myself what felt more necessary. But now that we moved away, I'm actually doing way better in terms of like my career. I'm having more shows that are actually quality. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Rather than like a bunch of little things. And also for the first time, I'm able to make a living from my work. That was never the case when I lived here. And as an artist, I know that that doesn't always last. And I'm also not like making a ton of money, but I can rely on my art to sort of do what I need to do to buy more materials. And so that has given me the luxury of not having to hustle so hard.
Yeah.
So it's almost like I feel that when we say these things that sound profound and kind of enlightened, I always like to point at the privilege of that place, you know? So I feel very fortunate at the moment to have a big studio with AC. When we lived here, I didn't have AC in my studio. So there was a huge chunk of the summer where I couldn't paint because it was literally too hot.
You would just die.
Just take days off,
yeah.
You know? And now I'm like, I can paint whenever I want. So I don't feel like I need to work as hard or hustle as hard. I can focus on the things that really matter, which is the work. I read a lot more. I write a lot more. I draw. I have like a drawing practice, which I never had before. So my energy is actually going into like the good stuff, not the appearance of good stuff.
Yeah. Wow.
If that makes sense.
That sounds fantastic.
Yeah. And I mean, we'll see, you know. Hopefully it lasts, but you know, I have friends who are older whose careers have been like roller coasters, who do really well. They make money, they buy a house, and it's like goes down and they're like struggling to make it back up. So you never want to get too comfortable, I feel. You know, you don't want to be like, I've made it. But always know that if you're having a good moment, enjoy it. It might not be here forever, and kind of be grateful for what you have.
Yeah, I love that.
Yeah, but also not be paranoid, because if you're paranoid, then you can't continue making the work, you know?
Yeah.
So it's like finding the space where you're humble and kind of working. I don't know.
Yeah, it sounds like you guys have found the perfect space for the time in your life.
Yeah.
Or I guess the life stage and the stage in your work as well. Do you feel like if maybe this opportunity had come up 5 to 10 years ago that you would feel differently? You know, I feel like maybe when I was younger, moving to a place like Roswell, I mean, even probably now, I probably wouldn't go for it, but
yeah.
You know, I'd be like, oh no, I need to be in an urban center where absolutely. I can meet people and I can go out and,
Yeah. I mean, that's a great question. I tell people that so much of why we love it as much as we do, it has to do with our age. I'm 35 and Josh is about to turn 40. So, I had my wild phase. I went to the clubs. I went to the parties. I went to the art shows. I mingled and I did it and I kind of got sick of it. You know, when we lived here, we thought we needed to show up for everything and meet everyone and go to all the things. And we realized like nothing happened. Nothing happened from those things. So there's this almost illusion that you need to be there and that because we're always hoping that we're going to go to this event and the dealer, our dream dealer, is going to be there and they're going to meet us and they're going to fall in love and they're going to give us a solo show.
Yeah.
Sadly, it's not how it works.
Mm.
You know, and I think part of realizing that that's not how it works, and I don't know how it works, but I know the way we were doing it, it doesn't. So it felt okay to leave because it's not, you know.
And you'd also looked under that rock and now you know. You know?
I know. And it maybe works for someone.
Right.
And, you know, not everyone's destiny is the same. You know, I think for us it was, so actually back to social media, both of us started sort of generating the careers that we have from Instagram. So this is the kind of positive, you know, gallery reaches out, hey, do you want to do a show, a residency, this and that. So a lot of the kind of momentum also happens there. And I'm working with a gallery in Dallas who I love, Conduit. And I don't know if I would have ever thought that I would be showing and doing well in Texas. When I was in grad school, I only thought about the coasts, you know, the West Coast and the East Coast, New York. And I showed a lot in California and really like in a commercial sense, not much was really happening. I think it's also timing. And also maybe it's just that my work wasn't that good. I would like to believe that the reason why I'm doing better now is because the work got better.
Mm.
You always want to think it's the work.
Right.
But I also know that that's not how things work. So I have no idea. I also decided I'm going to try to not psychoanalyze everything.
True.
Because that's like a waste of energy again.
Yeah.
You're like, I don't know why all of a sudden now a museum bought my piece and not 2 years ago. Do I think it's that much better than the work I was making 2 years ago? No. But it's the timing, you know, people always say it's like the time and place.
Mm-hmm.
I think it's the mystery working. It's magic and kind of making.
I'd rather think about the, or surrender a little bit to the mystery.
You have to.
Yeah. Because if you try to replicate something that you think was working, it's like the odds are.
There is no formula.
Yeah.
There's no template. It's like, this is how I did it. And this is how you can do it. Because everyone's path and work and
that's awesome.
Yeah,
so we've I think before in previous interviews maybe we had touched on a little bit of the darkness in your work, and I was wondering if that ever feels oppressive or attached to you as a person. Like do you feel like you carry this darkness around, or can you still be optimistic and how does that affect you on like a regular life level?
Mm-hmm. Well, I do think that our experiences shape us, you know, especially early childhood experiences. It's like the whole nature nurture thing. Like, are you born that way or is it because of what happened to you that you're behaving in this way? Right. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, I definitely think that my background has a lot to do with why I make the work that I make. I was 7 or 8 years old when the war in Bosnia started. I spent 3 years moving through various refugee camps with my mom, where she then met my stepdad and my sister was born. And I watched my sister, you know, be born in a refugee camp where we were like waiting in line for food. So there was a lot of scarcity, a lack of safety, and a sense of transience in my early life that I think is what my work touches upon. without me doing it intentionally. It's just in there. I think it's in my body.
Yeah.
I think that, but I don't know. I mean, I think you would have to ask people who know me whether I'm a a pessimistic or optimistic. I think I would say I'm an optimist. But I think there are traces of dark stuff inside of me. And I believe that there's trauma happening all the time in the world. And maybe, if anything, what I'm trying to do is make pain visible. Because often psychological stuff is we don't even treat it the same way as we do cancer, for example, right? Or like what your insurance will cover.
Right.
Like if you just say, I'm dealing with depression, I think you'll have a harder time getting your insurance to, you know what
yeah,
I mean?
Yeah, of course.
So I'm very interested in the psyche and how it processes and absorbs and then puts stuff back out, you know? So I think my personal trauma is connected. I almost think that there's like a web of darkness that has happened before, that will continue to happen.
Even before you were born.
Even before I was born. I mean, all atrocities that have ever happened, any genocide, like the Armenian genocide, the genocide that happened here, like with Native Americans, the slavery, the genocide that happened in my own homeland, where it was the second largest after the Holocaust. Like, I think my work is almost like connecting with all of that. And I'm not by any means saying all atrocities are the same. But I do think that there is like a collective spirit that I'm interested in touching. And I almost think of my work as being the canvas being like a net that catches the ghosts. And sometimes they're have transcended, you know, especially the work I'm making now that's really, really faint. A lot of them are feminine or female characters that are kind of looking up, and they're kind of beautiful in their gestures, but you could tell something happened to them. But I recently finished a painting, actually right before we came here, where this figure emerged that's screaming. And I was afraid of it, and I almost changed. And it felt immoral. It felt immoral to almost like send it back to the other side of the net. He or she, or they're kind of gender fluid, my people that I paint, they wanted to come out. And it felt immoral of me to say, you're not going to be commercially successful because you're screaming at the viewer. And I know that this painting is going to be difficult and might not do well. But I'm so glad I made it. And yeah, it's like back to the chakra points. And I just feel like I'm trying to let these ghosts out to tell us something about why we're in pain, why I'm in pain, why you might be in pain. And maybe in my pain, you can recognize your own, and that can make you cry and you can feel good.
Right.
You know, so it's like, if there is darkness, I'm not trying to perpetuate it. I'm hopefully making work that feels more tender so that your own darkness can be almost like hugged or almost like I want the paintings to feel like a safe place to be sad. You know, like, don't be ashamed to cry here.
Right.
You know, they're kind of giving permission.
Yeah,
part of the... Or at least that's what I'm hoping they're doing.
Yeah, do you feel like it's part of the healing process?
I do, and I also know how... I mean, I went to a really conceptual school, CCA, where even the word healing would have been like, don't use that word.
Yeah.
I mean, I remember working on my artist statement and like getting words crossed out, like no-no words. And it feels...
Tell me more about that. What are the no-no words? And CCA stands for...
California College of the Arts, which I loved. I loved going to school there. But it's a really conceptual school. Really, everything I'm making is not stuff that I feel like would have been supported there. My way of making work, in other words, I don't start with ideas and then make paintings. It's like I literally play with paint and I,
and then
dare
the
I say,
come.
Have pleasure making it. And then the content emerges.
Yeah.
So it's not, but like the no-no words like spirit, healing, God, I'm blanking on them now. But, you know, we think of them as words associated with like the boohoo hippie thing.
Yeah.
And I feel so good to unapologetically use words like that now when I talk about my work. And the person who's rolling their eyes when they hear me say it, I would love to talk to them.
Yeah.
And see what makes them tender. Like, we all roll our eyes at something, but the person who's rolling their eyes at anything that's about healing, I'm really curious about that. And like, what's it like to be in their body?
Right.
You know?
Wow.
I don't know. But it feels good to be out of school, you know, to like be like, oh, I'm not making this work for the critique. It's for me, and it's hopefully for whoever will be moved by it.
So did you move? So when you went to school, was that because at that point in time, you're like, I want to be an artist, so I'm going to go to this conceptual, I'm going to go to art school?
Yeah.
Or did you have another idea of what you wanted to do when you?
Well, you know, it's kind of like I went to CCA because it was a super conceptual school. And I wanted to learn how to talk about my work. And I felt it was, it's my hometown. I would be near my family. And it's a really, really great school. So part of the kind of
area
in the, in San Francisco,
okay.
They have two campuses, the one in San Francisco and one in Oakland.
Okay.
So the graduate, maybe it's changed since then. I graduated in 2009, but at the time all the grad programs were in San Francisco. So I really wanted an ass kicking.
Yeah.
And I got it. I mean, I think it was really hard for painters, especially. This whole conversation about painting is dead, which I find so boring, but it was very prevalent. You know, why are you still painting in 2009? So this was like a question. Why are you painting today?
I wasn't really familiar with that conversation. So is it because of everything being digital now or?
I think it's also like, it's like a very much like an art school conversation. Whenever I talk about it with people who haven't been to art school, they're just like, what do you mean it's dead? You know, and I'm like, oh gosh, I have to remember that there's like this whole other bubble. It's called the art world. And
yeah, well, maybe modern painting. I don't know, because when I go to, I feel like I go to a lot of contemporary art museums, and I guess I see contemporary art in all forms, and some is older. And when I say older, I mean if it's contemporary, I guess, you know, within the last 100 years or 200 years. But and I guess I see some newer artists, but it's hard for me sometimes to wrap my brain around, you know, painters of today or people that I know now. At what point does it go from gallery to museum?
Mm-hmm.
or if there's less painters now than there were before, and just trying to connect that to the painting is dead thing.
Well, they were more painters. I remember in my class, it was a small class. I think there were like 60 of us, but they were more painters entering the program than painters graduating. In other words, people changed mediums.
Right.
And I think I was one of like maybe a handful of painters that were like still painting to the end.
Right.
Why do people say painting is dead? I mean, I don't know. I think there's so much emphasis on concept, you know, an idea, and then sort of almost like finding the best medium to execute your idea. Mm. And I don't even like the word execute. I mean, what does it sound like, you know? But when you're using a material like painting is very sensual. It's also very bodily. And in a way, the way that I paint, it's almost like celebrating the sensuality of it. And that's also something that's not in vogue. And I can see why an institution would not be interested in talking about it, because it doesn't sound academic, right? Or how do they measure that you're like learning and improving if you're like engaging with this medium in this like really sensorial way? I don't like a lot of contemporary painting. I mean, there's a lot I like, but there's also a lot that I don't. I mean, a lot of my favorite stuff that really gets my juices going is stuff that was made long ago, like cave paintings, you know, art made by outsider artists or people I worked with when I worked at Hope Center for the Arts, you know, with just artists with intellectual challenges. They're like bastardized in the art world. They get like a room called outsider art, you know, or self-taught artists. And so there's this, I'm really interested in them, you know, and they are part of the art world, but again, in their little group, you know,
right,
they're not in the marginalized group. So, and then painting is always like, and you know, I saw this show in San Francisco at the De Young a couple years ago, and there were, it was a show, of Black artists from the South who were self-taught. And I was so moved. There was a piece by Thornton Dial that just crushed me. It was, I might get teary-eyed talking about it even, but he was like a crucified looking black figure. And I forget when he made this. It was made out of like shoes and socks and like spray paint, like all kinds of materials. And I was reading the wall text and he talked about God a lot. And a lot of the other artists, like there was Jesus, God, Spirit all over the wall text. And I was just like, you never see this in museums. You don't see so much Jesus talk, like, you right. know? And then I was like, I'm not Christian, I'm not religious, but like, what if I wanted to use the word spirit in my work? I have a feeling it would get crossed out, or like the curator would encourage me to use a word. So then I was like, I almost felt like, it's interesting that they were allowed and they were like not shamed for using that. And it's like, I realized they were like self-taught artists. And I almost felt like why do self-taught artists almost get, it's almost like condescending, like, oh, you can talk about God because you don't know any better, you know? But in the contemporary, like artists who've been to art school, like they're not really going to talk about God because they know better. So there's like these strange marginalized spaces in the art world. And I feel like I want to be with the marginalized people, but I have a degree. But the things they're talking about is more interesting to me than what the art school stars are talking about. And the art feels like it really came from a place of authenticity and a personal voice where they don't care about the art world. And these art stars, I feel like, are so making work for the art world, you know? So I don't know. I kind of went off on a tangent here, but
that makes sense. It makes me think about this, just things that you've kind of forget about this division between secularism and, or intellectualism and,
yes.
you know, spirituality and how, or I was going to say church and state, but just yeah. like, this hard line that's sure. like you either believe in this or you don't.
And then if we decide you get to be in the museum, you have to be of this group of artists if you want to be talking about that stuff that we intellectuals know not to talk about. Yeah, and I care about that stuff less. I'm just like, I'm going to use the word spirit if I want to, you know, knowing that it might turn a bunch of curators off.
Yeah.
And that's interesting to me that it's turning them off.
Yeah.
I might be crazy and shooting myself in the foot, but.
No, I love that. I think that's awesome. I think there's really like just a strong sense of just like a authenticity, you know, I think that is really refreshing.
Thank you.
About you as a person.
Thank you so much.
And of course about your work as well. So
thank you. I really enjoy your questions and we could go on forever. Yeah.
Keep doing it. Yeah. So what do you feel like is the next step for you in your work? Are you looking to work in new mediums? Is there a new place you want to go in the globe or galleries, museums?
Well, this year has been really exciting for both of us. Josh and I have been traveling quite a bit. And coming up, I have... so there's a two-person show that we have up in L.A. right now that opens today.
Awesome.
And that's at Big Pictures L.A. It'll be up for about a month.
Until... so we're in September.
September 7th. And I don't know the exact closing date, but they're usually up. Yes, sometime in October. When I get back, I'm going to Albuquerque. I was invited to do a two-week residency at the Tamarind Institute. So I'll be working with a master printer making lithographs.
That's awesome.
So I've dabbled a little bit earlier this year. So I'm really honored to be doing that in a couple of weeks. And then after that, I'm going to San Francisco to do a one-night show/fundraiser at Altman Siegel Gallery for one night, and I'll be raising money. I'll be donating 50% of my proceeds to the Center for Youth Wellness, which is this incredible program founded by Dr. Nadine Burke Harris, who I heard speak on TED Talk. She gave a TED Talk about trauma. Sorry, my throat is really dry.
Okay.
So she gave a talk about toxic stress or intergenerational trauma and what it does to a developing child. So she started the center in Bayview in San Francisco, and they basically diagnose, they have this questionnaire. I think it's called the ACT or gosh, I knew it. I knew the name of it, but it's a way of, it's like a score sheet that tells the child, the higher their score, the more likely that they're going to suffer from all these things later on in life. So they help that child or adolescent get treatment. So I really love what they're doing in the sense that my work deals with intergenerational trauma, and they're really dealing with that, like literally, not like,
early
development. They're really trying to like make a change in this child's life. So I reached out to them about a year and a half ago, and now we're finally got to a place where we got a venue and we got a show. So I'll be doing a show where half of the proceeds will go to them.
That's amazing.
And then after that, I have my very first solo show in New York at Denny Dimon Gallery. And then in February of next year, I have a solo show with my gallery in Dallas with Conduit Gallery. So a lot of shows coming up, and I'm making large oil paintings. I haven't been making a lot of small oil paintings. I just haven't felt compelled to do that. So I started drawing. I have this like new drawing practice where I draw for a couple of hours every morning, and they're just black ink. And it's been really interesting to kind of get rid of color with the works on paper, but still investigate color with my oil paintings.
Yeah.
And then I've continued making my phantoms, these sculptures that are made out of fabrics, but they're growing. It's like my kids are growing up. And I plan to have an installation of them, as well as oil paintings, ready for my February show. So I won't have them ready for the December New York show. But in February,
Dallas?
In Dallas, yeah. I plan to show oil paintings, sculptures, and maybe even drawings.
That's awesome.
Yeah.
Wow, that's amazing.
Yeah, I feel really, really lucky that all these things have kind of opened up, and hopefully, you know, things will continue opening up. So, yeah.
That's great.
Keep making work.
Yeah, and people can find your work learn more about you at your website?
Yeah, I think the best way is probably my Instagram. Back to social media. I feel like I uploaded more frequently, which is Maja Ruz. That's my handle, MAJARUZ, or in my website, which is ontheedgeofreason.com.
Amazing.
Yeah.
Great. Well, thanks for joining.
Thank you so much, Yore.
I really enjoyed it. Cool conversation.
Oh, I'm so, for me too.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. I have one more question.
Okay.
just because we spoke a little bit about wellness. So if you had one piece of advice for any creative people out there or artists that that want to know how to integrate wellness into their own lives, or like what that even means, obviously that's going to be different for everyone.
Sure.
But, you know, like what would you say to someone that's looking to find, you know, their wellness along their creative journey?
Oh, gosh. Such a hard question, because I could say so many things, starting with drink lots of water,
you know,
exercise, you know, don't drink too much, go to bed early, wake up early. Those are all little things I do that I feel like have improved my productivity.
Yeah, move to New Mexico.
But the main thing I would say, and I don't even know if this is good advice, this might be the worst advice, but here it is from me as good advice, which is stop focusing on career. I like cringe when young artists like use career as this thing. And I just want to be like, why are you an artist? Explore that. Work on your craft. Are your paintings good? Think about your paintings before you think about shows. But again, somebody else might tell them the exact opposite. I just find that to make good work, you have to find a way to make it even if the art world didn't exist. And that's maybe the question I would ask. Would you still make this if the art world didn't exist? And if the answer is no, I'm worried for them.
That's real.
Yeah, that's just what I think.
That's real. I love that.
Yeah.
Oh, well, thanks, Maja.
Thank you so much, Yore. I love talking to you.
All right. Cheers.
Music for the podcast is by Rarebit, a.k.a. Justin Dosher-Hopkins. Editing assistance is by Matthew A. Paul and Kelly Kekich.